Hachette Audio presents Back to Human: How Great Leaders Create Connection in the Age of Isolation. Written by Dan Schawbel. Read by Robert Petkoff. Includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF. To Jim Levine, my literary agent. Introduction. How technology is isolating us at work. Our hyperconnectedness is the snake lurking in our digital garden of Eden. Arianna Huffington. While watching Black Mirror, the popular British science fiction anthology on Netflix, I was amazed at how well the nosedive episode reflects our current society. The story is set in an alternate reality where people can rate each other using their smartphones, and those ratings impact their lives. Lacey, the lead character, is obsessed with her rating, much like many of us obsess over the number of likes, comments, and shares our status updates gain. She starts the episode with a rating of 4.2 out of 5, but needs at least a 4.5 to be able to move into the more luxurious neighborhood where her friends live. Her friend Naomi, who has a 4.8 rating, asks Lacey to be a bridesmaid at her wedding. On her way to the wedding, Lacey encounters a series of misfortunes that drive her rating down to a mere 2.6. As a result, Naomi asks her not to be in her wedding anymore. Although the show is fictional, this episode perfectly illustrates how technology can divide us as much as bring us together, and it holds up an unforgiving mirror that shows us how guilty we are of making unconscious social comparisons that make us, and everyone else, miserable. Modern technologies have impacted our workplaces in ways that would have been impossible just a decade ago. Instant messaging, digital platforms, and video conferencing have completely changed how, when, and where we work. A Gallup survey found that over a third of the entire U.S. workforce has worked remotely, and Freelancers Union reports that freelancers also now make up more than a third. Robotics and artificial intelligence have supercharged our productivity at the cost of replacing tasks and even eliminating full-time jobs from our economy. McKinsey found that half of today's work activities could be automated by 2055, accounting for almost $15 trillion in wages globally. On the positive side, networks, apps, and smartphones have created a more social, collaborative, and flattering global workplace. According to the Harvard Business Review, over the past 20 years, collaborative activities have increased by 50% and now account for more than 75% of an employee's day-to-day work. But more and more of that collaboration is occurring within social networks and mobile apps, with a far smaller percentage happening in person. There's no stopping the evolution of these technologies. They'll continue to transform and reshape our work lives every year. To give you a sense of just how quickly things are changing, when the telephone was introduced in the latter part of the 19th century, it took several decades for that new technology to reach half of all households. A century later, in the 1990s, it took fewer than 5 years for cell phones to reach the same penetration. Future devices could prove even faster than that. Our devices offer many incredible benefits, including real-time interactions, efficiencies in workflow, creation of new ideas, and access to resources. At the same time, those devices have disrupted our relationships and made our workplaces more dysfunctional. Instead of strong bonds, we have weak ties. Instead of productive meetings, we have distractions. Technology has created an illusion that today's workers are highly connected to one another, when in reality most feel isolated from their colleagues. What they crave most, and what research increasingly shows to be the hallmark of the highest performing workplace cultures, is a sense of authentic connection with others. Technology addiction is increasing. This is especially true of younger employees who grew up with technology and are more likely to be early adopters. They happily use these devices to obtain instant gratification, alleviate stress, and receive personal validation. But there's a darker side to this technology use. On an episode of 60 Minutes, Tristan Harris, a former Google product manager, admitted that these devices are intentionally designed to make us addicted to them. Every time we pick up our phones, we're pulling a lever in the hope of winning an exciting reward, much like using a slot machine. Although it's tempting to think that Harris is speaking metaphorically about tech addiction, it's actually a very real thing. Every time we receive a text or status update, we get a jolt of dopamine in the pleasure system in our brains, the same system that controls addiction to drugs such as cocaine. Before smartphones existed, people spent an average of 18 minutes a day on their computers and other electronic devices. Today, we're up to a whopping 5 hours a day, during which we tap our phones an average of 2,600 times. About half of Americans are so addicted to their devices that they'd rather break a bone than their phones. Besides putting huge amounts of money into the pockets of device makers and technology companies, our addiction is reprogramming our minds and shaping our actions, feelings, and thoughts. It's also interfering with our relationships. Author and thought leader Simon Sinek has observed that when young people experience stress, they aren't turning to a person. They are turning to a device and social media that offer temporary relief. This coping mechanism has made us depressed, isolated, and less effective in our lives. Two global studies conducted by Future Workplace in partnership with Randstad found that what younger workers say they want has very little to do with how they actually behave. The majority of the 6,000 22 to 34-year-old workers polled in more than 10 countries told researchers that they prefer in-person communication to technology. Nevertheless, over a third spend approximately 30% of their personal and work time on Facebook. Instead of having in-person meetings and phone calls, we choose texting, instant messaging, and social networking. Many of my peers even become frustrated when someone calls and leaves a voicemail, which they view as an interruption. Workplace loneliness is spreading. When we rely on devices to connect with other humans, our relationships become weaker. Replacing human interactions with text messaging makes us lonely and unhappy. The result is an isolation epidemic that has reduced the percentage of people who say they have a close friend and has left half of all Americans feeling lonely in their public lives. Dr. Vivek Murthy, a former Surgeon General of the United States, told me that loneliness and weak social connections are associated with a reduction in lifespan similar to that caused by smoking 15 cigarettes a day and even greater than that associated with obesity. To be fulfilled at work, committed to our teams, and happy, we need to focus on building deeper relationships with the people around us. The famous Harvard Grant study by George Valant followed 268 Harvard undergraduates for 75 years, collecting data on multiple aspects of their lives at different time periods. Valant discovered that the best predictor of life satisfaction wasn't money or career success, it was strong relationships. A few researchers have studied the correlation between the loneliness that isolated employees feel and their commitment to their teams. The consensus is that having work friends and team camaraderie can make a huge difference when it comes to job performance, loyalty to the employer, and employees' overall well-being. At Wharton School of Business, Sigal Barsaid interviewed 672 employees and their 114 supervisors and found that greater employee loneliness led to poorer task, team role, and relational performance. In a separate study, John P. Meyer and Natalie J. Allen found that the quality of employees' interpersonal relationships has a significant impact on how they perceive and connect with their companies. Employees who are lonely are more likely to feel a lack of belongingness at work and have a lower commitment to the company. Gallup interviewed more than 5 million people and found that just 30% have a best friend at work. Those who do are 7 times more likely to be engaged in their jobs. In a separate study for this book, Virgin Pulse and Future Workplace polled more than 2,000 workers in 20 countries and found that 7% of workers have no friends at work and more than half have five or fewer friends. Those with the fewest friends felt lonely very often or always and were not engaged in their work. This is especially important for people of my generation who consider their team their work family and their boss their work parent. No one wants to leave their family for a group of strangers at another company, just as no one wants to let their family down by being a poor performer. Isolation in the workplace has caused employees to seek more intimacy, be more empathetic, and build deeper friendships. After surveying more than 25,000 employees from 10 countries, we found that remote workers who rely on collaborative tools are more likely to pick up the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.